Good morning, everyone, and welcome to worship on this All Saints Day. I'm so glad that you could join us, and it's a special day for all of us around the church and throughout time to remember those who have been a part of this church, not just here at St. Timothy's, but in all times and places, all the saints. But we today are particularly remembering those who've been a part of this community. And at home, I want to invite you to find a candle and light it as well, and be ready to name the names of those who are on your hearts and minds, who you give thanks for, who you are missing, who you are grieving, so that as we join together, we begin today at the font, we are remembering that we are given new life in the waters of baptism. And that changes everything for us. So will you join me in this call to worship as we together give thanks for the gift of baptism? Joined to Christ in the waters of baptism, we are clothed with God's mercy and forgiveness. Let us give thanks for the gift of baptism. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and merciful, you are the river of life. You are the everlasting wellspring. You are the fire of rebirth. You are the fountain of resurrection. Praise to you for the waters of baptism and for your word that brings new life. Breathe your spirit into all who are gathered here and into all creation. Illumine our days. Enliven our bones, dry our tears. Satisfy all our thirst with your living water, Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. We come to worship you with all the saints of God.
Thank you. Please join me in a time of confession. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved. Amen. Holy One, we confess that we are not awake for you. We are not faithful in using your gifts. We forget the least of our siblings. We do not see your beautiful image in one another. We are infected by sin that divides your beloved community. Open our hearts to your coming. Open our eyes to see you in our neighbor. Open our hands to serve your creation. Amen. Beloved, we are God's children, and Jesus, our beloved, opens a door to us. Through Jesus, we are forgiven. By Jesus, you are welcome. In Jesus, you are called to rejoice. Let us live in the promises prepared for us from the foundation of the world. Please join me in a prayer. Lord God, you have surrounded us with so great a cloud of witnesses. Grant that we may persevere in the course that is set before us, and at the last, share in your eternal joy with all the saints in light, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from 1 John, the 3rd chapter. Hear the word of the Lord. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Word of God, word of life.
Good morning, kids. I'm so glad that you're joining us for worship today. You know, I want to just give you a couple ideas about what this Sunday's about. And I want you to remember that, well, it's really all about remembering that Jesus is with us all the time. So today in worship, we have lit 5 candles, special candles, because there were 5 people in this last year that died here who belonged to this congregation, and their loved ones miss them. And I bet that you have also experienced a time when you miss someone, or when a favorite uncle or aunt or a pet even died. You know, those things are hard, but we are people who are shaped by Jesus and the power that he has always in our lives, because he rose from the dead. And we don't want to experience death in our lives, but we don't need to be afraid either. So that's what these candles are to remind us about, are these 5 wonderful people that we'll remember later in the service by name. I want you to think about someone by name that you remember. And I don't know if you can see, but they're in a semicircle here, because the idea is that those of us that are standing on this side and those of us who are with Jesus in heaven are all one big circle, and we are all together because that's how God is and that's how much God loves us. I want to tell you about a special book that Emily shared with me. It's called The Invisible String by Patricia Karst. And it has stories and pictures. And in one page, they are thinking about how they're all connected by an invisible string. And they say, Jeremy quietly asked, "Can my string reach all the way up to Uncle Brian in heaven?" And his mom says, "Yep, even there." So remember, when you are lonely or when you're afraid, there is nothing that can separate us from the love of God. And that's what we're remembering on this All Saints Sunday. Will you pray with me? Dear Jesus, thank you for those we have loved and for those we miss. Help us to remember you are with us always. Amen. Grace to you and peace from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. You know, I have heard that in the British Isles, there are certain sites that locals call thin places. Someday I hope I can visit one. Now, it's not that the altitude is any higher or the air any thinner in those spots. They are just called thin simply because it's believed that in those places, somehow the distance between heaven and earth shrinks, and that the veil between the two is so thin, you can actually perceive something of heaven itself. Over the centuries, people sensed the deep spirituality of those sites and built structures of worship upon them. In an earlier call that I served in the ELCA, I was called a mission director in a synod, and it was my work then, part of it, to partner with others to think about where new churches might be planted. And by that time, when sowing the seeds, hoping for a new congregation to emerge with a sense of God's call, you know, when we were doing that, we were taught to look for places to locate where church buildings might eventually be built that would have high visibility and accessibility So as we were seeking to grow, people could find us in the suburban realities of cars and highways and mobile, very mobile communities. But we weren't actually taught to look for thin places. Now, pondering this on All Saints, when we gather for this festival, makes me think of this space where I'm standing today that this congregation shares. No matter where you're viewing this from today, here on the corner of what we can now identify as 93rd Street and West Dodge Road in Omaha, Nebraska. We can hear the traffic soaring by as I speak. But I think, remembering that even before this congregation was developed and planted here, and before this land was the cornfield that was on someone's farm, before that even, people had crested this beloved hill on which we sit. Before one could view the soaring spires of St. Cecilia's as you come over the hill, we would have seen the rolling landscape finding its way down to the wide Missouri. So the Omaha, Sioux, Pawnee, Oto, Ponca peoples, they may have found this very spot, and maybe they sensed God's presence here. But the site of our church was surely chosen because of its good access to our automobiles. So I invite you to think about that because, you know, opening our minds to imagine and acknowledge that there have been others in this place before us might actually help us to imagine and to live in ways that are faith-filled in the present, in a way that opens us up to God's future, the future that God is bringing to us. So friends, no matter where you are located on this All Saints Sunday, our worship this day seeks to become a thin place where the veil between what has been and what is to come is more translucent in our lives. And so we purposefully think about loved ones who no longer dwell in this world, the people that we know, the people that we miss. We all know that the anniversaries of their life and their death and our moments that we shared with them can kind of create a sort of thin place where the distance between heaven and earth seems to somehow shrink, where we sense their presence and know they are in some way still with us. Their wisdom, their guidance through the hope that we share in Jesus Christ almost touches us, so that in grieving and remembrance, God comes very near. Now, if you happened to commit Luther's small catechism to memory, it probably means you're a nerdy Lutheran like me. It's not that hard, though. Any of us can do it. But you'll remember the second petition of the prayer that Jesus taught us to pray is expounded upon in this profound way. Luther writes, "The kingdom of God comes, indeed, in and of itself. But we ask in this prayer that it may come also among us, also among us." For Luther says, God's purpose will ultimately be accomplished, but we are praying that it will happen in our life together today. We are looking for the thin place where heaven comes to earth and where touching the kingdom of heaven seems possible for those of us who are weighed down by earthly realities. So, a question this morning. If you've read the 66th book of Scripture recently, of course, it is called the revelation to St. John, I hope your life has been enriched. That's what we're reading from on this morning. Too often we have shied away from it because it does seem less accessible than the letters or the stories. It's almost like it's written in code. In seeking its message, many authors have created ideas like the rapture and made us wonder whether we might be left behind. And some see in this book a roadmap to the end of the world, and they've based predictions on their interpretations of the esoteric details in this writing. But I believe instead that God speaks through this John to broadcast a message of hope to people in the midst of great suffering. I hope you too will hear the promise of God in Jesus Christ on this day, and that you too might be strengthened to live in hope and without fear, that you too might encounter a thin place where God's promise seems to reach out and touch you. So hear now our reading for this day, All Saints Day 2020, from the 7th chapter of the Revelation to St. John. Beginning with verse 9, he writes, "After this I looked, and there was a great multitude that no one could count, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, robed in white, with palm branches in their hands. They cried out in a loud voice, saying, 'Salvation belongs to our God, who is seated on the throne, and to the Lamb.' And all the angels stood around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures, and they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, singing, 'Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen.' Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, 'Who are these, robed in white, and where have they come from?' And I said to him, 'Sir, you are the one who knows.' And he said to me, 'These are they who have come out of the great ordeal. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. For this reason, they are before the throne of God and worship him day and night within his temple. And the one who is seated on the throne will shelter them. They will hunger no more and thirst no more. The sun will not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb at the center of the throne will be their shepherd, and he will guide them to springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eyes.'" Word of God, word of life, right? You know, in my journal recently, I came across where I had made a journal entry about cheering for my son's football team in a certain particular game. In that game, the opposing team had come undefeated late in the season, all the way from Florida, and both teams played hard. Aaron's team got a couple of lucky breaks that they were able to capitalize on, and in the end, with grit and determination, they were victorious. Now, because of the way that that field was set up and where we were sitting, we ended up walking after the game right through the players from the other team as they came off the field. And I found myself, you know, I'm a pastor, wanting to say something encouraging and sincere and comforting. But I couldn't think of anything that wouldn't sound hollow, so we just passed silently through. Now, I know that it's just a game, right? And that only one team can win. And I also know that it feels so good when you do. But I felt in that moment a longing for it to be possible for all those who had worked so hard to win, for everyone to feel that joy, for everyone to hold their head up high. Well, John, to whom this vision in the book of Revelation is given, may have been a refugee from Palestine to Asia Minor, we think, following the trauma of the Roman-Jewish War, a very hard time. And perhaps scholars believe he actually lived kind of a dual identity as a Jew by heritage, who now believed in the promise of Jesus, and who was writing to Greek-speaking people. He was in a land, a place unfamiliar to him. He was writing in a second language, not resettled, not at home, not comfortable, looking for hope, longing for what was familiar, and yet looking for God's presence in the moment, and wanting to share that with the whole. So as he looked for God's provision for everyone, for all who had fled and were suffering this persecution, God gave him this vision. And in this vision, people endure through a great tribulation, we say. And then they join together to worship the Lamb who is their shepherd. Such a great multitude, the vision says, no one can count. You don't need to count. Join together around the throne of God. They will be sheltered from hunger and thirst and led by the Lamb to the springs of the water of life, and God will wipe away every tear from their eye. What we struggle to see and experience now is yet still a signpost for where we are called to travel. And that is a place where all means all, where everyone is gathered and welcomed. Everyone is joining their voices, cheering on every team, pulling together. I mean, if winning a football game can seem satisfying even when you're not the one on the field, imagine what it will be like when we are united around the throne of God, when we are standing in the thin places, we can glimpse such a world. The kingdom of God comes indeed in and of itself, but we pray in this prayer that it may come also among us. And our perspective is changed when we pray that prayer together, and when we sing, and when we come into God's presence in worship, no matter how we gather. Because you know, the truth is that in this world, on this side, we all have our blind spots, our prejudices, our downfalls. We all have some mixture of being winners and being losers within us. Saint and sinner, Luther says. And in that space that we call heaven, all of us, saint, sinner, winner, loser, all of us will find ourselves alongside of people with whom we've long disagreed, against whom perhaps we have been holding grudges, people who look so different from us, arriving from nations we have branded as enemy, and the people we have failed to see because of their poverty or their vulnerability, and they've been hidden from us. We'll all be standing together in the light of Jesus Christ, right beside the people who have heard us and the people who have helped us. We will be together where God's promise to wipe away every tear extends, yes, to this tribulation that we are experiencing today, our ordeal of the corona and the racial pandemics that continue to haunt our lives and claim so many. In this vision given to John, it seems that, you know, heaven is actually a very active place, and people are worshiping and serving God, and all the people of every tongue and tribe and nation are gathered around and singing, blessing and glory and honor and power and wisdom and might be to God forever. Don't let this tribulation that is with us now divide us one from another. We are called to see God in our neighbor, in one another, whether they have gone astray, whether they are to be celebrated. We are called to care for the least, the last, the lost, the lonely. We are able to do this, church, because in Christ we are being made new again and again, sustained for God's purposes. And on this day, as we worship with all the saints, may the veil between heaven and earth be lifted for you to reveal how you best might follow God's call to you and to give you peace, that you might see a glimpse of heaven come to earth in Jesus Christ. Amen.
And I hear the Savior say, and thy strength indeed is small. Child of weakness, watch and pray. Find in me thine all in all. As Jesus paid it all to him I owe. Sin had left a crimson stain. He still white as He washed it white as snow. He washed it white as snow. Yes, he did.
Let us join together as we remember all the saints. God of the ages, we give you thanks for the saints, those of our day and of days before, who nurtured us in faith, who told us the stories of Jesus, and who cultivated among us the sense of our call to follow your path. Help us to remember them and to follow their example, to nurture their expectant hope and to live our lives so that others might see your love reflected in all that we say and do. Oh, thank you, God, for the gift of your saints. For all those who have faithfully served you, witnessed bravely, and died in the faith, and who are yet still shining lights in the world, we praise you, O God. And we especially praise you for our brother, Jesus. For you are the God of Abraham and Sarah, of Moses and Miriam. You are the God of Joshua and Deborah, Ruth and David. You are the God of the Old Testament prophets and priests, of the New Testament apostles and martyrs. You are the God of our mothers and fathers, the God of our children. You are the God of all people through all generations. And so today, let us remember the saints that we have known and loved, those who have laid a foundation in faith for us, those who are still alongside of us seeking to walk the way of Christ. Dolores Ruth Johnson, January 1st. Rosemary Good, May 1st. Utah, Larrick, May 21st. George Lee Stewart, September 7th. Norman Roger Grew, September 23rd. O Lord Jesus Christ, for loved ones now gone, who have been saints in our own lives, parents, teachers, mentors, and friends, we give thanks as we remember the names of these beloved. So for the lives of the saints among us who continue to touch us along our faith journeys, we look ahead with hope to the people whose faithful witness to God's love will inspire future generations. Keep us grateful for the witness of the saints of all generations, and make us, like them, eager to follow in the way of Jesus Christ. And then at last, complete the circle, O God, and bring us all together to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. Let the people say, Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'm so glad you could join us here for worship today. Before I send you with a benediction, I want to draw attention to a request from our Nebraska Synod bishop and staff that we seek to together find ways to unify in an election season that has been so decisive and divisive. Bishop Ryan sent us a prayer to use on this day, and I would like you to join me now as I lead us in prayer and then send you forward with a benediction. Let's pray. Almighty and ever-loving God, Prince of Peace and Ruler of all, hear us as we call to you on behalf of our nation. Grant us wisdom and discernment in the decisions we will make. Grant us grace to heal the divisions we've allowed among us, and renew our goodwill and generosity of spirit, that we might dare to pray that we be one nation, united in our commitment to the good, under your wise and merciful guidance. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Now may the God of all creation, in whose image we are made, who claims us and calls us beloved, who strengthens us for service, give you reason to rejoice and be glad. May the blessing of God, sovereign Savior and Spirit, be with you today and always. Amen.